Good morning, Church of All Nations. This time. I'm hot then. Come on, put your hands together. Hey.
I'm blessed when I crush, persecuted and not abandoned, pressed down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse that His promise will endure, and His joy will be my strength. Though sorrow may last for the night, joy comes in the morning. I'm trading
my sorrow.
I'm trading my shame.
I'm trading my shame.
And I'm laying them down.
I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'm trading my sin. Yeah.
I'm trading my sin. Yeah.
I'm trading my pain. Persecuted, not abandoned, pressed down but not destroyed. I'm blessed beyond the curse that His promise will endure, and His joy will be my strength.
Though the sorrow may last for the night, joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrow.
I'm trading them all.
I'm trading my shame.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, raise your hands if you regret your choice for Jesus Christ. Yeah, I know nobody regrets giving their life to Christ, do you? The best decision you ever made, is it? I was telling the first service that I remember as a nine-year-old boy in the Baptist church going up to the front where they set out the two chairs for the invitation to the fellowship. And I remember as a child looking at the deaconess and saying, "Can I go up there?" And she said, "If you want to." And that has been the best decision I ever made in my life, even as a nine-year-old child. My life has never been the same. And I am so thankful that I gave my life to Him. There's so much I'm experiencing today that I know I'd miss out on if I had not received Jesus, if not received that baptism of the Holy Ghost. I encourage anybody in here, if you've not let it go, let it go. Give your life to him. Accept it. It's a free gift of salvation to you. Open your arms to the ones whose arms are wide open and receive the gift of salvation. This morning, we're going to praise him. We're going to thank God that we can build our life on such a pure foundation that is the Lord Savior Jesus Christ, the rock that cannot be moved. Amen. Can we just raise our hands and say thank you? Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. We bless you this morning. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Yes, we do. Sing Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Yeah, yeah. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. He's worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy. Above every other name. Yes, it is Jesus. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. He's worthy, worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Yes, we do. We live, for you. Sing holy, holy. There is no one like you. There is no you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to know. Holy, holy, there is no one like you.
There is none beside you.
No one.
Oh,
He's holy, he's holy, he's holy, he's holy, he's holy, he's holy.
There is no one like it. You're holy, you're holy, you're holy, you're holy, you're holy, you're holy, you're holy. There is no one like it. He's holy. Your own song, sing to the Master, sing to Jesus this morning. We love you, Lord. We're gonna build our life on you.
Oh, I will build my life upon your love.
Hallelujah. It's a firm foundation, firm foundation. To a holy God this morning. Lift up a praise to a holy God this morning. He is higher than high. He is greater than great. He is the King of kings and Lord of lords. If royalty came into this place, you would position yourself differently. Well, he's here right now. There is no king higher than Jesus. There is no Lord greater than Jesus. Can we honor him right now? Can we make sure that the next words of our mouth is hallelujah? That the next words of our mouth is praise you, Lord. We love you, God. We just want to say we love you. We just want to honor you, Lord. Lord, hallelujah. You, but I feel his spirit right where I am. And I treasure it, so I know what I'm feeling. I implore you, pull on Jesus right now. Wherever you are, I got anointing right here. Pull on it from where you are. Receive from the Holy Ghost this morning. Receive from the Holy Spirit this morning. He made a way for me. Don't know how, but he did it. Don't know how, but he did it. I'm standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test. Holding on to faith. Nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out, and you're watching us now. When it looks as if we can't win, wrap us in your arms and step in. Everything we need you supply. Now we know that you
We're standing here only because you made a way. And I'm standing here only because you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, praise him. Praise him. He made a way out of no way for you. He made a way out of no way. Just right quick, I told it to the people this morning. Where Moses and the Israelites came to the Red Sea. We all know the story, but just imagine the feeling. You got the enemy at your back. You got hopelessness in front of you. There is now no way. There's no way out of this. And Moses would dare go to God and say, there's no way. And as if God was saying, you're talking to the wrong person. Every element that you see in front of you obeys my will. The waters will move the other way if I say so. Your sky will turn from blue to purple if I say so. So just stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. I am telling you now, for anyone who has yet to see the Lord move, just wait a little while. Just later, wait a little while, and you won't have to do nothing but say, Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. Jesus, make a way. And you will watch the impossible become possible before your very eyes. Please lift your hands and say thank you. Lift your hands and say thank you for the miracle he's already done, the miracle you have yet to see. We thank you, Jesus. You made a way. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, keep your hands lifted as we continue to worship the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I don't know who I'm talking to right now, but God is ready to do the impossible in your life. He's getting ready to do the impossible in your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus came and loved me, took my sin to Calvary. He has made a way for me. Now my eyes are open, since I've come to know him. His great love has set me free. And at the cross, my debt was paid. All my sins were washed away. Amazing grace at the cross.
eyes are open.
Now my eyes are open since I've come to know Him. His love has set me free.
Come on and sing at the cross. Sacrifice, we think about the crucifixion all the time when we do communion, but he didn't say just do it when I do communion. Just every time you get a moment or an opportunity, remember what I did for you. Every moment you worship, every time you gather, every time you come together, every time you're alone, think about what Jesus had done for you. His blood that was shed, it satisfied the wrath of God. And today we have an opportunity for eternal life because of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who gave his life for me and gave his life for you. Can we give him praise for what he has done for us? God, thank you for your blood. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for your blood. God, we lift your name up this morning, thanking you for each and every person who made the decision today, Lord, to get baptized, to confess you as their Lord and Savior. Because we know it's not just us in this moment, in this time, in this church that's rejoicing, but we know that all of heaven is rejoicing with us at this time, in this moment. So God, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for your Son, oh Father. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your blood. We give you thanks and praise for who you are. May you continue to bless the rest of this service for us this morning. As your presence leads us, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. And all God's people say, amen and amen. Can we give God a loud shout of praise? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Before you're seated this morning, do me a favor. Look at the person next to you and greet them and give them a big hug and a greeting. Say, I am so happy that you're here with me this morning. Once again, welcome Church of All Nations. This is the best place to be on a Sunday morning in Boca Raton, isn't it? Amen. I believe with you on that. Today we have a very special group of people. We say that every morning, but we mean that every morning. And so, but this morning we have a special, special group of people that comes all the way from Orlando Christian. If you guys are familiar with Pastor Pedro Pejeda, who is one of our pastors here on staff, brought his entire staff with him this morning. Could you guys stand up and be recognized this morning? We love you all. Welcome to Church of All Nations. Make yourselves at home. We love you guys so much, so much. And also, if this is your first time at Church of All Nations, we want to recognize you as well. If this is your first time, please lift up your hands right where you're seated, and we'll see you, and we'll have our ushers right over here come to you, and they'll deposit something in your hand. And in that bag or that packet, you'll find some information about our church. You can step outside into the guest breezeway, and we have a gift for you also. If this is all, your first time online with us, we do want to make you feel welcome. We don't want to leave you out. So please leave a message or a comment in the comment section, and we'll send you a link, and we'll connect with you from there. Church, do you know what week we're in? Ooh, I like it. You don't know. It's a very special week for the United States of America. This Thursday is July 4th, the 4th of July, where we get to celebrate our freedom. Amen? And with that, I'd like for all of us to stand up real quick as the choir leads us into the Star Spangled Banner. May God bless.
Good morning and welcome to Church of All Nations. Thanks for being with us in person or online. God is moving throughout our church. Let's check out what's coming up. This week is Independence Day. We hope you have a wonderful 4th of July with your loved ones. God bless you. Today, after both services, Legacy Youth is hosting a bake sale in the front breezeway between services. God is doing big things in Legacy. Come show your support for our youth ministry by purchasing some delicious sweets and treats. Legacy Youth is also hosting their very own mini summer camp. The cost is just $20, including lunch. This is an opportunity for students to fellowship with one another, experience God's presence, and shift their perspectives by showing them that church can be fun. Don't miss Legacy's mini summer camp, July 5th. Speaking of summer, join Pastor Boykin and our church family for our summer of prayer by interceding for our daily prayer points, reading our daily Bible passages from the book of Acts, and by joining one of our prayer groups. You can also follow along on social media for daily prayer. Is today your first time at Church of All Nations? We're so glad you're here, and we have a team excited and ready to meet with you. We appreciate you spending your Sunday with us. You will receive a connect form from our ushers. Once you fill it out after service, please bring it to the guest reception in the front breezeway. We want to connect with you. Stay connected with us by picking up a bulletin at the Welcome Center, and don't forget to follow us on our social media platforms, and go ahead and check out our website and our church app. Thank you, and God bless you. Happy 4th of July! And now, let's get back to our service.
Amen. We thank God for His goodness. We thank God for the family of God. We thank each and every one of you for being here. God is moving in this place. We do want to encourage you, participate in our 50 days of prayer to summer. It's an opportunity for us to dedicate our lives to the Lord and to reprioritize our lives to put God first. Amen. If you did not pick up a brochure yet, you can pick one up at the Welcome Center following the service. And now is the time in our service where we bring our tithes and our offerings to the Lord as an expression of our worship, our surrender to God. And I want to encourage you, church, each and every one of us, to put God first in our lives. Amen. Let us put God first in our lives. Because when we make seeking and serving God our priority, then we know every need in our lives will be met. Can you say amen to that? When we put God first, every need will be met. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verses 31 to 33. Jesus declared, "So do not worry, saying, 'What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Can we say praise the Lord to His word? God does not want us to worry, and God does not want us to fear. When we put Him first in our lives and in our finances, we know He's going to supply all our needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. We're bringing our tithes and our offerings to the Lord today, and I want to encourage you in three areas to put God first in our finances. First, let us trust God. That's why we're here today. We're believing in God. We know He's real. He's alive. He's a God who exists, and He's a good, good Father. Amen? Our God is a good God. He takes care of His children, and He is the source of our provision. Jesus said that God knows what we need even before we ask. If God takes care of the birds of the air, if He takes care of the lilies of the field, if He takes care of the grass of the field, He's going to take care of you and me. Amen? The people that He loves. So let us put God first in our finances. Let us trust in Him as our source of provision, and He will meet our needs. Second, let us obey God. Remember, Jesus said, "Seek first His kingdom." Putting God's kingdom, seeking God's kingdom means putting His kingdom first. And in the kingdom of God, all things are done according to God's will and according to God's way. Amen? God's way is always best for us, right? That's why He's given us His word. It's our guide. It's our direction for life and godliness. When we put His word into practice, we will always be blessed. So let's obey God. And when we do, when we give our tithes and offerings to Him, as we are doing today, He will always bless us and meet our needs. Finally, let us please God. We can obey God, but God wants us to have His heart. Jesus said, "Seek God his righteousness. Let's seek to be like God, who is so good, so merciful, so gracious. So when we give, we seek to please him. We give willingly. We give generously. We give faithfully, and we give compassionately. Amen? That is God's heart. And when we seek to please him, we know he will bless us. We're going to have the ushers to come forward at this time. Remember, people of God, you don't have to worry. You don't have to fear. But let's press in to God. Let's put him first in our lives. Let's trust him. Let's obey him. Let's seek to please him. And that's a promise of his word. That's a promise that Jesus said, that he will give us all things. Amen. He will give us all things that we need. Let us pray. There's 5 ways that you can give. You'll see on the screen. If you're here in the sanctuary, you can deposit your tithes and offerings in the bag as they're received by our ushers. Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, you're an awesome God. You're a good God. You're a gracious God. You're a faithful God. We trust in you today. We decide this day to put you first in every area of our lives. We put you first in our finances, bringing our tithes and offerings to you. Thank you. Your word is true. If we seek your kingdom and your righteousness, all these things shall be added to us as well. Thank you. You're a God who blesses abundantly above and beyond what we can ask or even imagine. So we are coming to you before you in obedience. We're coming before you wanting to please you by bringing you our tithes and offerings. Bless each gift. Bless each giver. We know many have different types of needs. Thank you. You're going to move. You're going to operate. You're going to meet each need according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. We pray your blessing upon each one. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said amen. Thank you for your giving today, church.
Oh! Good afternoon, church. Man, we grumpy? What's going on? We just celebrated, we just worshiping and all. Good morning, nothing, man, what's going on? Well, it's an honor and a privilege to be here to share the word of God and never take this lightly. Shout out to Pastor Boykin for allowing me to be here and just share a word that God has placed in my heart. That he's been speaking through me for a couple weeks already on this matter. But before I move on, I just want to give a big shout out to Pastor Pedro, Ms. Rosangela. Man, once again, it's awesome to see them, my dear friends. This man and this woman right here have been through thick and thin with me, and I just want to say thank you, love you, appreciate you both so much. Amanda, you in the house too, girl. What's up? How you doing? My little sister. I got Mizel here. Mizel's in the house. What's up, Mizel? And his wife. He's here, and I'm excited for that. And so, church, I'm just excited. You excited? No, you're not. You excited? Man, I feel like I'm in kids' church right now. Y'all hungry? Well, I'm just going to give you spiritual food, not real food. So, is that cool? Well, you guys know I like to goof off a little bit, but, you know, when it comes to the Word of God, we got to get down and dirty. Hello? And so I'm just excited again to just share a timely word with you. And God is good. I said God is good. And all the time? Come on, you know it. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And if you don't have your Bibles, you can pull out your iPhones, iPads, Droids, and you know the other stuff you guys have. Palm Pilots, Blackberries. Man, we're going old now. I'm sorry. I'm pumped up from first service. I apologize. And my wife gave me something like from Dunkin' Donuts, like energy drink. That's not cool, man. I don't even drink stuff like that, but it's all good. I'm just kidding. Here we go. This is what the Word of God says. It says, we do not know what to do, but we are looking to you for help. Watch this again. You could highlight that on your Bible. You could underline it. You could do whatever you want, but this is what the Word of God says. We do not know what to do, but we are looking to you for help. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you. We thank you because you're such a good God. And today, Lord, I pray for anyone that is dealing with an issue, any drama, any problems, any circumstances, any situation. Lord, I pray that this afternoon that they will leave out of this building empowered by you, Holy Spirit. So, Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever said this kind of phrase to God? I don't know what to do right now, God, but I need your help. I don't know what to do in this situation, the circumstance, but God, I need your help. It's good when you cry out to God. You make God known to you. And in this case, we got King Jehoshaphat. He is the king of Israel, one of the good kings, because we've heard that Israel has had bad kings. But in this case, King Jehoshaphat was a good king. And so King Jehoshaphat and Israel received word that three armies are coming to declare war on Israel. Three armies to attack little Israel. You and I look at them like, whoa, that's crazy. They're going to get jumped. They're going to get murdered. They're going to get massacred. That's crazy. Three armies surrounding Israel. Israel is outnumbered. It's an unfair fight. And just like other battles, battles come out of nowhere. Hello? Maybe this week you were enjoying everything. Everything was going sweet. Everything was amazing. And all of a sudden, something comes. A circumstance comes. A situation drops on your shoulders. And now you're like, oh, what's going on? And we read 2 Chronicles 20, 12. It says, we do not know what to do, but we're looking to you for help. Amen. So in the midst of the battle, King Jehoshaphat cries out to God in front of Israel and says that verse. We do not know what to do, but we are looking for you to help us. When I moved from Chicago to beautiful South Florida, remember, I'm from the Midwest. And in the Midwest, we only have, listen, this is me, now I could be different. But when I grew up, all I knew was African Americans, Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, Guatemalans, Americans, Greek, and Polish people. That was where I was at. I come down to South Florida, and I get introduced to Haitian people. Hey, ça passe. Hello. And then Brazilian people. Oi, tudo bem? I know, isn't it crazy? Living here, you already know the language. And so as a 10-year-old kid going to Boca Middle, going to sixth grade, I'm going and I'm hearing these languages. I'm like, oh, I kind of understand that. That's like pork and cheese. Okay, that's a mix of Spanish, but they're messed up. Yeah, something's wrong with them. And then you got the Haitian people. And at the time, listen to me, please do not judge me. I'm from the Midwest. We said pop. Now I say soda. Hallelujah. I got to meet some people and I'm like, oh, wow, you're speaking Haitian. Oh, that was the wrong thing to say. I did not know that. Listen, if you come to me and say, oh, you speak Guatemalan, I don't take offense to that. Hallelujah. Yeah, I'm Guatemalan. A tall one. Praise God. Hallelujah. But man, let me tell you, I went around like, oh man, you're speaking Haitian. Oh wow, Haitian. Ah! But one day, one of the guys, a Haitian kid, got mad. Once again, newbie. I said, oh, you're speaking Haitian. Turn into the Hulk. It's lunchtime. I said, I'm sorry, eyes are red. I'm like, oh, Lord, what just happened here? I'm going to be in my first fight. This man gathers other Haitian kids and said, after lunch is over, we're fighting. Ça passe! Piti, piti! Uh-oh! I'm telling you. So I'm sitting there thinking, oh, snap. All because I messed up. So here we are, lunch is over. We go outside, and here is now a big, giant circle around me and these guys. I felt like Israel. Listen, I read this. I'm like, that sounds like me in sixth grade. Israel's outnumbered. Unfair. You know who's going to win. 3-1, hello? So here I am, I'm thinking, oh Lord, here we go. Any Chicago boy will do is get ready for a fight. So I was ready, put my fist up, and I ran. Fam, you have never seen a fat boy run. This man ran. I ran, and I even looked back. Woo! I got away from that, but then later, can I tell you, later we got to become friends and great things, but that's how Israel felt. outnumbered. Israel couldn't run. Israel was surrounded. I had a chance to run. I broke. It was like the Red Sea. I ran. But that was my battle at that time. And some of us are in the midst of a battle right now. Raise your hand if you're in a battle right now. Physical battle, spiritual battle, a mental battle, anxiety, depression. Come on. And we're in the midst of a battle, and we're sitting there saying, man, I don't know what to do. Maybe we've been in this battle for days, months, and even years. And yet we're still, Lord, I don't know what to do. But here's my thing. We all want to get out of a battle. We all want to get out of a situation. We all want to get out of a circumstance. And I'm here to tell you something, beloved. We are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. Listen, we all want to get out of battles. We want it to end today. We want it to stop today. But let me tell you something. There's something through a battle that makes you stronger. It's through those circumstances that makes you stronger and a better person, and it makes you get closer to God. I shared with you a physical, now here's a spiritual one. 2 weeks ago, I had the opportunity to go minister at the West Florida District. They say West Florida, but literally it's like I was in Marianna, Florida. It's not even Florida. It's like lower Alabama. I was culture shocked, y'all. And so we went there, and it was 2 camps in 1 week. And so I was already prayed up. I was like, Lord, I pray that you will open the hearts of these kids to receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Lord, I pray that you will baptize these kids in the Holy Spirit, that kids will come out speaking in tongues. Lord, just do it. Right? I'm in the spiritual warfare already. Can I tell you something? The moment we pulled into camp, I get off the bus. I go to the back of the bus where all our luggage is at. I try to pop that door open and the door handle breaks. All my gear's in there. I said, I am not staying with these same clothes for a whole week. That's nasty. And plus my gear's in there, my electronics, my setup, everything. So I'm like, Lord, what am I gonna do? Already the enemy attacking. Because the enemy knows what is going to happen that week to kids. And so if you look, there's the door handle. You could call me Hulk, I don't know what happened. But the door handle broke. So I said this, I said, Lord, you gotta give me the brains. You are the creator of this world. Give me the creativity. So I called Joe. I said, Joe, listen, man. He goes, do whatever you have to do. Do whatever I have to do? Okay, here we go. So I go inside the bus. I walk towards the back of the bus, and I knock on the back. Ah, it's wood. I looked at Christiane and said, Christiane, give me your knife. I'm making a hole in this bus. Show them the picture. I hope it's not a video. Boom. It's okay, y'all. No one got hurt. Just the bus. It's a holy bus now. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. You got to rejoice with me. But we were able to get our stuff. But let me tell you something. It came out so good. The number of kids that got saved that week, the many of kids that got baptized that week, kids being rededicated to Jesus that week. Listen, there is a spiritual warfare that happens every single day between us and the enemy. And let me tell you something, it's a real thing. It's a real thing. And a battle is not us being late to work and we're trying to look for a parking spot and you can't find a parking spot, but all you find is a handicapped spot. And you park there and say, oh, I'm just going to park there because I'm late. You get off, all of a sudden you get off work, and you find a ticket at your door. Oh, the devil's playing me. No, he's not. That's your fault. A lot of times we give credit to the devil when it's your fault. You hear me? And another thing, how many guys love ice cream? I love ice cream. Ice cream is so good. But sometimes when you're craving that ice cream, and you're like, you know what? I need to go to McDonald's. Oh, I need to go get myself some ice cream. And then you get there and all of a sudden, you find out, once again, that the ice cream machine at McDonald's is broken. That is not a battle, family. Oh, the Lord, the enemy's attacking. He doesn't want me to have ice cream today. No, maybe that's God telling you stop being, you know, fat. Hey, God can use anything. I'm telling you. God can use a donkey. But listen to me. But right now, some of you are in this battle. And this battle that you're facing is overwhelming you. It's heavy on you. And you're ready to give up. And you're ready to throw in the towel. You're ready to tap out. And can I tell you something today? Don't do it. Don't give up. Because that's exactly what the enemy wants to do. He wants you to tap out and for you to start questioning God and you start doubting God, because that is what the enemy wants to do with you. He wants to ruin the relationship that you have between you and God, and you and Jesus, and you, the Holy Spirit. Don't give up. So I want to encourage you this morning. I want the Holy Spirit to work in you. I want the Holy Spirit to minister to you. So I want us to look at the life of King Jehoshaphat. Because through this scripture, I learned a lot. Chapter 20, I just dug in, y'all. I love scripture. Anybody love scripture? Y'all not raising your hands. Man, y'all sleepy. Y'all need like some Starbucks or like some something. But we're going to jump into 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I want to break this down to you. I want to show you how we could understand a battle in a way. Maybe we're not going through a battle right now. Maybe we're not going through some circumstances right now. But can I tell you something? You will. It's part of life. You will have trials and tribulations. You will face battles. Maybe you're not in it now, but maybe you'll be in it later. So I want to show you some things in chapter 20 that has encouraged me that the next time I face a battle, I know I'll win. Hello? Because we're winners. Hello? We're children of God. Hello? And we always win. Gloria a Dios. Gloria a Dios. Here we go. So watch this. Verse 6 of chapter 20. Here's King Jehoshaphat saying this. That he prayed, O Lord God of our ancestors, you alone are the God who is in heaven. You are ruler of all kingdoms of the earth. You are powerful and mighty, and no one can stand against you. So the first thing we see here is this. In a battle, you gotta understand God's power. You gotta understand God's power. You're not playing with some make-believe God. You're not dealing with no Disney made-up character, okay? You're dealing with a true living God. And King Jehoshaphat knew that. He understood God's power. He's seen it in the past with his ancestors. He's seen God move. He understood that God was the Almighty. How many of you guys agree that God is the Almighty? But some of us, we say that, amen. But when it's your turn to fight in a battle, you're like, oh, where is he? Watch this, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. My grace is all you need. For my power is the greatest when you are weak. Did you hear me? My power is the greatest when you are weak. When I read that, church, I find this great comfort, this great peace knowing, because I know I'm a weak person. Hello, how many of you guys are weak in a battle sometimes? Come on. I know that when I am weak, that my God is there taking care of me. That no matter what I'm dealing with, God is right there. He is right there with me. So I understand God's power. It is not my own strength. It is not my own power, but God's alone. I can't sit there and say, oh man, he can't. No, I gotta sit there and say, yes, he can. He is more than able. God is more than able. He's so powerful. But there's nothing too big, nothing too small that he can't handle. Maybe to you it looks, man, that's difficult. There's no way God could deal with that. But you know what, something? You're just basically saying, man, God can't. There's nothing too big or too small that God can't do. He could do it. You just got to have faith. You got to believe. He is powerful. In fact, the Bible says that he's omnipotent. We need to believe in his power. Think about this, church. He speaks and it happens. Look at Genesis. He just spoke and creation took place. That's power. I speak, move. Doesn't happen. You speak, but man, God? You tell God to do something, God, man, the moment he speaks, it happens. That is the God we serve. That is the God that we worship. But here's the thing. A lot of us in this room, we doubt God's power. We question his power. Why? Because we look at others. We compare ourselves to other people. We start saying, man, look at them. Look at how their family looks. They have it all together. Oh, look at their jobs. Man, they're succeeding. Look at their finances. Look at the cars. We start judging. And then we start saying, God, what about me? I've been there. God, I'm a pastor. Hello? Are you blind? And some of us is like, I'm a Christian. Hello? They're not Christians. How come you're blessing them? So we start doubting. We start having unbelief. But can I tell you something, church? It's coming. It's coming. You gotta be patient. You might have a prodigal son. You might have someone that's addicted to drugs. You might have issues at your job. Listen, be patient. It's coming. It's coming. A breakthrough is coming. King Jehoshaphat understood God's power. He understood that, man, his God was gonna take care of him. So we gotta stop doubting his power. Watch this. I want you to look at verse 14. It says, the Spirit of the Lord came upon one of the men standing there. Now I'm going to skip to 15 because I can't say those names at all. They got a Spanish man trying to say all this stuff. He said, listen, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem, listen, King Jehoshaphat. This is what the Lord says. Do not be afraid. Don't be discouraged by this mighty army, for the battle is not yours, but. Now you're going to think I'm going to say, oh, you're going to talk about the battle. No, watch this. One thing that the Lord showed me in this verse was this. In a battle, who are you allowing to speak in your life? Let that soak in a little bit for you. Who is speaking in your life when you're facing a situation? Who are the people that you are surrounding yourself with? Hello? There's people out there who will stand by you when all hell breaks loose. You're going to have those people that are going to be there to encourage you and motivate you and push you. You're going to have people that are going to quote scripture, and those are the people you want to surround yourself with. You want to surround yourself with spirit-filled people, people who believe in God's word. You don't want to have doubters with you. Come on. Church, listen. You don't want those kind of people around you. Watch this. One of the things that I love is my mom. She's up there, and my dad. One of the things I love about my mom is that she's a prayer warrior. Fam, I'm gonna be honest with you. When I'm in a deep trouble or if I'm in a bad circumstance, my mom. She's the one that will pray and anoint my head. There's something about moms that don't give up. Did you hear me? There's something about that. I'll tell you this. Love on your mama. Pray for your mama. Then you got your friends. Just watch when something bad happens. ¿Qué pasa? You're going to have certain people like, oh, no, 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 no. And then you're going to have those like, oh, no, girl, let's go. Come on. We're going to go pray this through. Come on. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we're going to get through this. Those are the kind of people you need to surround yourself with. And in this case, we see that there's a man that is filled with the Spirit and is speaking encouraging words to King Jehoshaphat in Israel. Those are the kind of people I need in my life. Those are the kind of people you need in your life. People that will encourage you and push you to the next level. But not everyone you call a friend is a friend. Did you hear me? You're going to find that the hard way. You're going to find out that I thought they were a friend. And then you find out they're like out there, oh, did you hear what so-and-so is going through? Oh my gosh, do not get near that person. No, you need someone next to you that's going to lift you up, encourage you, and push you to the next level. Hello? Surround yourself with men and women of God. Listen, a lot of times we open the door wide open for a lot of people to come into our lives. I'm going to tell you something. My door is small. I don't tell everybody my business. Hello? You got to do the same thing. Don't be telling everybody your business. Listen, because then everybody's like, oh, they got all, everyone has an opinion. I only need God's opinion. I need a man or woman of God to come and say, you know what, Pivik, this is what you got to do. Watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 33. I got to hurry up. Don't be fooled by those who say such things, for bad company corrupts good character. Once again, be careful who you allow in. Be very careful who you allow in, because not everyone is there for you. Amen. Not everyone is there for you. Seeing people get hurt too much, people spreading rumors and gossip about other people when they're going through their horrible trials and tribulations. They're like wildfire. They're not there to support you. They're there to gossip about you. Watch this. Verse 16 says this, tomorrow, march out against them. You will find them coming out through the exit of Ziz and at the end of the valley that opens into the wilderness of Jeruel. But you will not even need to fight. Ooh. But you will not even have to fight. Take your positions, then stand still and watch the Lord's victory. He is with you. 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 Hello? Oh, people of Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid or discouraged. Go out against them tomorrow, for the Lord is with you. Watch this. Number three, in a battle, God requires obedience. Did you hear me? Obedience. God just told Israel, don't lift a finger. Don't fight. Stand still. That sounds kind of crazy. Three armies coming to attack Israel, and you're telling me to stand still and watch? That sounds kind of, God, what's wrong with you? But God requires obedience. He told them, and they stood still, and they watched. What is obedience? Watch this. I wrote it down. Obedience is connected to trust and respect. It actually comes from a Latin word meaning to hear. When we obey God, it is a sign that we will really trust him and that are listening to what he is saying and truly believe that he knows best. So obedience is trusting God. Do you trust God? And in this case, King Jehoshaphat trusted God. But imagine if King Jehoshaphat said, you know what? I'm not obeying those orders. That sounds nuts. You're telling me not to pick up my sword, pick up my shield? You want me to just stand still and just watch? No, I'm good. Israel, no, we're not listening to him. He's something's wrong with him. He's sleeping maybe. Let's go. But no, he obeyed. He obeyed. And church, all you need to do is obey God. Obey what he's telling you. Because I believe that if they disobeyed God, Israel would have lost. Israel would have been destroyed. Listen to me. Do you think that God knows what's best for you? We say yes in here, but later we're like, oh, God, really? Are you really testing me? God, do you really love me? Why am I going through this? If we sit here and we say, you know what, God? I think I know that you know that I need to do this because, you're trying to prepare me for something better. He knows what's best for you, and he knows what he's doing. God knows what he's doing, and he knows what he wants best for you. Watch this, John 14, 15. If you love me, if you love me, you will obey what I command. If you love me, you will obey what I command. Church, if you love God, you spend time with him. You read his word. You spend time in prayer. In a battle, you got to learn to trust God. Physical, spiritual, mental, you trust God. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what you're going through. But this was a word that God has been putting in my heart for some of you in this room. You might not be going in a battle right now, but later you might. And you will, because it's part of our Christian growth. It's part of us growing closer to God. So I need to learn God. I need to fully obey you. Listen to me. What happens when we disobey? There's consequences. You guys remember when you were a kid? Man, I remember when I was a kid. I disobeyed mom and dad, especially dad. Man, he introduced me to a lot of different things. If you're Spanish, you know. Anything around becomes a weapon. Hello? But you know what? It's because he always told me, my dad always told me this. I don't find joy spanking you, but I do it so you can learn. He wanted me to obey him. He wanted me to learn to obey my parents. In the same case, we obey God. We obey God. He's got your back. Just obey him. Watch this. Number four. We're almost there, fam. I promise you. Verse 20. It says, listen to me, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm. So number four, in a battle, remember God's promises. You gotta remember his promises, church. God was telling Israel, I promise I'll take care of you. I promise we're gonna have the victory. I promise. You gotta believe in his promises. You can't doubt his promises. Matthew 28, 20 says, and remember, I am with you always. Always to the end of the age. Church, through deep waters, even through fire, God is always with you. You got to believe that. It's a promise from God. Always working. He's working behind the scenes, leading you to victory. You might not see it right now, but man, my God is working behind the scenes. So don't doubt. Quote those promises. Read the scripture. Believe and hold those promises that God has given to you. 2 Corinthians 1:20. I love using scripture, y'all. I got to use scripture to back everything up. For no matter how many promises God has made, there are yes in Christ. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. There are yes and amen. Yes and amen. Scripture tells us that he will never leave us nor forsake us, church. He's always there. He is always near and not far. That's a promise. He's always there. Not far away from you. He's right there with you. Psalm 145, 13 through 14 says this. The Lord always keeps his promises. You want to highlight that in your Bible. Because some of you are like, he doesn't keep his promise. Says it right here. The Lord always keeps his promises. He is gracious in all he does. The Lord helps the fallen and lifts those who are bent beneath their loads. God is not like us, church. God is not like us where we break promises. We're the promise breakers. Oh, God, if you do this, I'll go to church more. I'll give more money in the offering. Oh, if you fix this situation, maybe you know, I'll lead someone to Christ. But you don't do it. God's not like that. It's not in God's nature to lie. It's in his nature to take care of his kids. And we are children of God. Do you believe that? Watch this. Last one. Miss Beth. Here, give it up for Miss Beth, y'all. Ms. Beth. That's Mama. Don't mess with Mama. Watch this, my last one. As I'm reading and then finishing chapter 20, we see that King Jehoshaphat remembers God's promises. He reminds Israel God's promises. Even though it sounds crazy to stand there and not do a thing, he still remembers God's promises. But watch the last one that the Holy Spirit showed me. At the very moment, verse 22, they began to sing and give praise. The Lord caused the armies to start fighting amongst themselves. That's crazy. So number five, in a battle, worship. You worship. Did you hear me? You worship. When you're going through a battle, you worship God. You don't sit there with your head down low. No, you look up to the heavens and say, God, I worship you. Even though I'm going through the situation, God, I still worship you. I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to fight, but God, I worship you. God, I open my mouth. God, I'm here. And Lord, I trust in you. You worship. Man. He put the worshipers at the front line. That's crazy. I'd be like, you're dead. You're not gonna make it. You're not gonna survive. You don't even have a sword. You got a tambourine. You can hit it with a tambourine. But God was showing them something. God was saying, I promised you. Now watch. So what happens? They're praising. They're worshiping. They're singing. Gloria a Dios. Hallelujah. Dancing. And what happens? The armies start fighting against each other. Israel is just sitting there watching. Singing. Worshiping. And the battle is happening. People killing each other. And Israel is still good. Israel is winning. Watch this. I might not see the light at the end of the tunnel, but God can. All you gotta do and know is that he is working behind the scenes. You continue to praise. You continue to worship. You continue to surrender. Man, you can even have vocals come out if you want. But you know what? You sit there and you spend time with God. Stop walking around with your head down low. And believe in your God. Worship your God. Lift in your hands. Listen to me. A lot of times we sit there and we don't even do this. Church, there's times that you got to do this. I surrender. I can't handle this. Here I am. It's through you. Church, we need to learn how to surrender. And can I tell you something? Worship is not just music. Worship is spending time with God, fellowshipping with him, praying. I'm gonna praise my God when things are going good and when things are going bad. I will not stop praising my God. He's so good. Watch this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18. In every situation, be thankful and continually give thanks to God, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. One thing I need you to know, that when you're in a battle, church, whatever you're going through, you got to allow God in your life. Allow him in. You can't do things on your own. You got to welcome the Spirit in and say, you know what? Here. It's yours. I can't handle this. God, come in. I need you. Come work in my life. Allow God in your circumstances and just watch what happens. those years, those months, those days will go like that. When you spend time with God, you're going to see how fast time goes. And when you spend time in His presence, circumstances just fade away, because the Spirit is there to comfort you. That's what I love about the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is there to give you comfort, peace, guidance. I'm so grateful that the Holy Spirit is here with us. I'll be lost without Him. But it's His comfort and His guidance that I need, knowing that when I'm in a tough situation, He's right there with me. Gracias, Señor. Gracias, Padre Santo. He's so good. I want you to bow your head and close your eyes real quick. God is so good. He is faithful. He is faithful. He is faithful. Remember, we're just here for a season. This is nothing. When we get to heaven, there's no more of that. We're just here passing by. Glory to God. But as we're down here, He's going to help us. We're going to make it through. If you're in this building, you say, Pastor Victor, I'm going through these issues right now. I'm going through this drama. I'm going through these problems. Health, finances, kids, spouse, addiction, whatever it is, whatever battle you're facing, all it takes is you coming to the altar and saying, God, I surrender to You. I can't do this on my own. It could be your business. I can't do this on my own. I need You in it. If that's you, let me get the altar workers come forward real quick. Altar workers, I pray that God starts using you to minister to these people, to God's children. In Jesus' name, may He use you to pray and give them encouraging words. Now, here we go. If you're in this building, you're saying, Pastor Victor, here I am. Here I am in the midst of a battle. I need prayer. I want you to come forward. Come on. We got an altar team here ready to pray for you. Is that? Come on. We got some space over here. Come on. We're all going to face some situations in life, family. But it's how we face those situations. I tell you this. Keep your head up. Don't surrender. Don't give up. Don't tap out. He is so good. He is so good. We thank You, Lord. Can we just stand and just spend time in worship? We're going to have the worship team lead us into some songs, but I want you to just, let's worship God. Let's worship God. Come on. Still here. I want to pray for you. I want to pray a blessing over you. So you can just close your eyes. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you that we were able to be here at your house. I thank you, Lord God, that you are a good God, a loving God. And Holy Spirit, I ask you to guide us, to lead us, to direct us. And also, Lord, when we ever face a situation, Lord, that you will remind us of your promises, and Lord, that we will just strictly obey. Lord, I pray a blessing over every home that's represented here. I pray for marriages, families, our kids. I pray a hedge of protection over our homes. And Lord, I pray in this new week, Lord, that we will shine the light of Jesus wherever we go, that we will be Jesus to somebody. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you, church. We love you. We're still going to minister at the altar, but we love you. Have a great week.
Hey. We want to say thank you for joining us today here online. We hope and pray it made an impact on you. If it did help you or encourage you in any way, we'd love for you to share it with others. Make sure to subscribe to the Cone Boca YouTube page, follow us on Instagram, and stay connected with us on Facebook, our website, and app. If you have decided to follow Jesus today, please email us at info@bocachurch.com and let us know. If you have a prayer request or testimony, or this is your first time joining us today, you can also email us there. We love you. God bless and have a great week.